get started, just as an introduction about us, we are a brand new group here at Baylor, the Science Policy Group. So if you're new and you want to sign up to get our emails, go ahead and do that on the sheet that's going around. This event's going to be recorded and put up on our website, so you can check it out there. But for our kickoff event, we are pleased to welcome Dr. Kenny Evans. He received his PhD in applied physics from Rice University in 2015. During that time, he also worked as a graduate research assistant for the Baker Institute. For anyone who hasn't heard of the Baker Institute, this is a globally ranked top five university think tank that's located right across the street at Rice. Dr. Evans works with the Baker Institute fellow Dr. Kristen Matthews, who teaches a course that's available to Baylor students as well in science policy and ethics. He also works under the direction of Dr. Neil Lane, who's the former science and technology advisor to President Clinton and served for 4 years. In addition to Dr. Evans' scientific contributions, he also served as an editor for the Journal of Science Policy and Governance, and he has published several policy-focused papers, appearing from Houston Chronicle to his most recent piece in Science Magazine, where he discusses advisor positions or the lack of advisor positions in the Trump administration. So today we hope his talk will inform us to get a sense of how this process works and what best strategies so that we can be best informed as scientists on these kinds of issues. So welcome, Dr. Evans.
Thanks. I did not expect to be introduced, so thank you so much for that. I've been trying to make all my talks the last few months nonpartisan, so I'm going to do my best to keep that true to form. But I should start by saying I don't really have any good news. The best news I have is that we know very little about science in the new administration so far. I'm going to give kind of just a broad overview of U.S. federal science policy and how it works. And how funding in general for research and development happens. Then I'll give kind of a context for the Trump budget, historical R&D budgets, and a closer look at NIH. And then I'll talk in depth about what we know about the Trump administration so far, the budget for fiscal year 2018-2017, and then I'll conclude with an outlook and a comparison to the Reagan budgets. I should say, please stop me at any time if you have any questions or general comments. I'm happy to talk, and I don't plan on taking up the full hour, so I want this to be as much a discussion as possible. Cool. So I'm going to start by plugging the Baker Institute. In September, like Caitlin mentioned, we've been focusing on kind of federal advisory structure for science, mostly in the executive branch. So we released this report. What we did is I wrote kind of this more like a research paper based on historical reports and change in the Obama administration. Then we got a lot of feedback from 50 to 60 policy scholars and federal officials. We kind of redrafted overhauled the whole thing, and then released it in September. And it's basically an outline, like a step-by-step plan for setting up the Office of Science and Technology Policy, which is the White House office that coordinates all federal enterprise for research and development. So I can talk about that in a little bit more depth. Here's a slide I stole from Neil. This is my advisor. This is basically kind of like an organizational chart of how science is funded in the United States. Everything is done by the president. Under the president, in the executive office of the president, there's the Office of Science and Technology Policy, OSTP. OSTP has two policy bodies. One is called the National Science and Technology Council, and this body is responsible for coordinating major interagency initiatives. So things like the BRAIN Initiative, things like the National Nanotechnology Initiative. There's separate offices for taking on large issues like climate change that basically expand many, many departments and federal agencies. Budgeting is done through the Office of Management and Budget, which coordinates R&D budgets with the Office of Science and Technology Policy. And then you've got, of course, all the president's cabinet. It's the major ones that you're probably aware of, NSF, NASA, EPA, energy, all these have large R&D components, but then others do too, like agriculture has a $2.5 billion R&D budget, transportation has close to a billion dollar R&D budget. This is something I didn't know before starting at the Baker Institute. So R&D kind of is spread out, and most agencies have some kind of research component to their missions. So all these R&D efforts need to be funded. In fiscal year 2017, the total budget for both discretionary and non-discretionary funding was about $4.2 trillion. As you can see, I guess from this graph, the bulk of this is tied up in mandatory spending, so that's programs like Medicare and Medicaid and Social Security, and you've got a thinner slice that's all in the interest on the federal debt. And then what's really important for research and development is the discretionary budget. And so when you hear about Trump's budget, he's not negotiating entitlements, he's negotiating this smaller orange piece of the pie, which is where all of R&D is located. So about half of that, roughly, and it's been this way for decades, is defense, and half is for non-defense. Defense, of course, does a considerable amount of R&D. The other half is non-defense, and usually that's split up close to half and half between basic and applied. On the defense side, it's almost entirely development and applied research. Cool. So here is a complete chart of federal spending, total federal spending as a percentage of GDP. So the takeaway from this graph is that the percentage of federal spending as a percentage of the GDP has decreased, and decreased substantially basically since 2001. So this big jump is after 9/11. Back here is kind of the Apollo program. And so this is really what is troubling the most scientists, is that the percentage of the total spending of GDP that goes to the discretionary budget, which funds all of R&D, is shrinking. So that's the takeaway there. But what is interesting is that R&D still remains about 10% of the total discretionary budget. So, and that number has been constant since, I guess, the late 70s. And so most people, when scientists or science policy people are discussing the budget, they usually just say, okay, what's the discretionary budget? The R&D budget will be 10 to 12% of that number. And that's been true for about four decades. Here's fiscal year 17, like I said, 2016. Here's the defense side for R&D, and it's almost entirely development. And the non-defense side, here's basic. So this is historically how things have been for ages, ages being several decades. And so no one really expects this to change. And I guess until President Trump was elected. There's a major report came out of the American Academy for Arts and Sciences that basically talks about this shrinking piece of the total expenditure of federal R&D as a percentage of the GDP. And so you can go read that. It kind of discusses options for change that aren't just necessarily pandering towards getting more money for science, things that'll make scientific research more efficient. So cool. All right, so I thought I'd talk, instead of just giving numbers, I'd talk about how the budget process actually works. Let's see. Cool. So usually thought to split up between four phases. The first phase usually starts 18 months to 2 years in advance, and it's just agency planning. So each federal agency that does R&D plans and starts long ahead before the budget even meets or hits the Senate and House floor. So usually what happens in about each summer, the Office of Management and Budget and the Office of Science and Technology Policy relay the presidential initiatives of that year and presidential priorities of saying, this is what I want R&D to happen. So whether it's climate change, whether it's health, whether it's physical sciences, some priorities. So these are the agenda we have coming from the White House, this is what we want done. Can you guys tailor your agency mission to meet our goals? So that memo comes out. It's usually, you know, 5 or 6 pages long. It's signed by both the OMB director and the OSCP director, saying this is the coherent strategy we want from this particular agency to meeting our end goal. And that memo has been happening since about the late 80s. Even during the Bush era, that was something that happened. Cool, so phase two, what happens with what's called passbacks, which is the agency submits their proposed budget back to OMB. OMB reviews this and says, we don't like this, or we like this, you need to change this, and basically gives a final ruling on what their budget's supposed to be. Then in January of each year, the president submits the budget to Congress, and then Congress, once it's been finalized between OMB and OSTP, it goes to Congress. Congress then is divided. Both the House and the Senate have 12 subcommittees on appropriations. Science agencies range through pretty much all 12 subcommittees. Each of them has their own separate budget and needs to be approved by the committee before it comes out back to the House or Senate floor. Also, the House and Senate eventually need to agree on what this budget should be, and that ends up being fairly contentious. Usually, before the entire budget bill comes to the floor, all 12 need to be passed by the committee, so this process can take some time. In the meantime, what happens is usually in April, a budget resolution is passed. A budget resolution it's not law, meaning the president doesn't sign it, but basically it sets caps for discretionary and non-discretionary funding, including R&D. What's interesting about this process is all these subcommittees for appropriations, for instance, NIH sits in the Subcommittee for Labor, Health, and Human Services, Education, and Related Agencies, meaning that it's competing directly for funds from the Department of Labor and also the Department of Education, in addition to DHHS. So that makes things challenging for an R&D and always having a stake in related with respect to other related agencies. So Representative Tom Cole and Senator Roy Blunt are the two chairs of the House and Senate Appropriations Subcommittee for NIH, and generally they have the most say of what ends up happening in terms of budgets coming out of committee and meeting a larger appropriations committee. So phase four, a budget they have till the end of the fiscal year, which is every year it starts in October, to pass the full budget, have it signed by the president. If this doesn't happen, they pass what's called a continuing resolution, which is basically funds all government agencies at their existing levels from the previous year. Since the 1976, there's only been 4 fiscal years in which there hasn't been a continuing resolution. Since 2007, it's happened every single year. Basically just means there's a giant fight in Congress and no one's decided on the budget, so they can have these piecemeal bills up until a larger bill where things are passed. And that's what's happening now in 2017, is there's been 2 continuing resolutions. One is set to end on April 28th, so they need to pass a new one or just pass a full budget by that time, or else what happens is the government shuts down. Usually shutdowns only last a day or two. I think in 1995, under President Clinton, it lasted something like a month, which basically just means everybody except for the Postal Service and other central agencies just goes home and doesn't work and doesn't get paid. So it's kind of like a disaster. Cool, so R&D, go ahead.
Since a lot of funding isn't done for 1 year, how do they handle multi-year funding down the road for different years?
Yeah, so at any given time, there's 3 budgets in play. So one, if we're in now, we're still trying to pass 2017. Trump is really 2018, and the agencies are already working on the 2019 budget. But for multi-year projects, this is a real problem for research, because a lot of times these big long-term projects, so NASA, for instance, is the best example of this, where you'll have a program that's supposed to take 20 years to complete. That program is at the disposal of Congress every year it needs to be appropriated. So what happens is a lot of times money is authorized. So for instance, with the 21st Century Cures Act, money has been authorized, but it still needs to be appropriated. So the legislation passes and says this money is available to Congress to appropriate, but it needs to actually be appropriated every year. So in the sense for cures, people are, at least health policy people are excited on some level, because some amount of money right before Congress broke down for the recess passed some actual appropriations bill, so they're getting $900 million that goes towards 21st century cures. But for longer projects, so that's a 10-year program. It needs to be appropriated every single year. So every year that there needs to be a budget that says this much is going directly towards this byline. So it ends up being really costly for scientists, and NASA's the one people point to because, so Obama was like, we're not going to the moon, we're not going to Mars. Trump comes into office and says, we're going to Mars. So where does that money come from? It usually comes from other programs at NASA that are already existing that kind of start this program. And then a new president can come in 4 years or 8 years later and say, now we're not going to Mars anymore, that program is nixed, and so all of this money went towards it. So it basically is contingent on Congress committing to a program and saying, we're going to fund this, and then having that continue for a decade plus, but that's been a real problem. Yeah, so essentially, pretty much all long-term programs, especially ones that come out of the White House, are subject to dealing with politics in this way through this process. So have an initiative, it sounds great, but it needs money to actually follow through and happen. It needs a long-term commitment. And so a lot of times what happens, especially in continuing resolution years, scientists don't necessarily know, or agencies don't know when they're funding grants. Is this fund going to be available even in 3 months when the new budget passes funding? So it ends up being a difficult situation. So I think Obama is a good place to start in terms of context for research and development funding. Mostly just because he was very aptly and publicly a pro-science president. He's not the first president to make science part of his political agenda. The first Bush was very adamantly pro-science. Clinton was pro-science. And Ford, for instance, was very pro-science. A lot of presidents have been pro-science. And he stated in his inaugural address he's going to restore science to its rightful place. People debated whether that's happened or not. Usually the main indicator for science policy folks is, what about the budget? So this is starting in 2009, the budget for several major federal science agencies and various components of those. So 2009, this big spike is the American Reinvestment and Recovery Act. So a lot of that went to scientific agencies. This is percentage change from 2008 levels. So basically, if it wound up back at zero, it meant that the budget hasn't changed in constant dollars from 2008. So there's a big spike. Most of that went away the following year. I was focusing mostly on NIH, NIH is this kind of pinkish line. It took a dip. Basically, it was underneath this kind of zero line and kind of scooched back up towards the end when 21st Century Cures was passed. It's debatable whether the White House it's ultimately Congress that decides, is science a priority in terms of funding? And more particularly, it's the chairs of these appropriations subcommittees that really have quite a bit of power in this process. So you saw Roy Blunt and Tom Cole earlier. And they've come out already in strong disagreement of Trump's NIH budget, but it's essentially up to them to come out and say this is we're going to go back and forth on this, and we're not going to let this budget fly. So that's them. And closer to home, the chairman of the House Science Committee is John Culberson, whose office is about 2 miles away, and he is. That subcommittee has jurisdiction over NSF, NIST, OSTP, and NASA. So he's pretty much, he's really feeling it right now. We met with him last month, and he's like, finally I get to, this is, you know, this is my time to shine, I'm gonna have my agenda. And he's got his own specific plans for NASA, and he's gonna write those in. And of course, it's debated both between the House and the Senate, and then Congress and the President. So it's a long term process. Cool. So NIH, particularly under Obama, this graph shows the President's request versus the actual percent change in the NIH budget. So I thought that this graph was pretty telling, in the sense that you know, for 2 years. Fiscal year 11, he asked for a 3% increase and he got a 3% decrease in total NIH budget. In fiscal year 2013, when the sequestration took effect, he didn't ask for a change and he got a minus 5% change. And then he did a little better towards the end of his tenure. The notable thing about Obama's health and biomedical program is that it was marked by three major White House initiatives. Talking to congressional staff, they hate initiatives from the White House. They have a budget plan already set, and they basically get blindsided by some announcement that says, all right, we're doing precision medicine now. Make room in your budget for it. And so they have to scrim, basically a House Science Committee and Senate and related Senate committee have to basically go and change the budget and say, all right, we're going to make room for the President's request. So these long-term initiatives, the Brain Initiative, Precision Medicine Initiative, and Cancer Moonshot, these are the long-term programs as Obama's leaving office. So a lot of people in the science policy community don't really have kind of mixed feelings about them. And one, they're bringing the public's attention to these big issues. On the other hand, it's really hard to have sustained funding and actually see these programs through. So a lot of presidential initiatives don't make it more than a few years, because if they're a political statement from the previous administration, on the way out, those programs just disappear. So in terms for NIH funding under Trump, these particular initiatives, it's just unclear if Trump's going to pick up the slack and say this is something we're going to do. One initiative that I guess has had legs is the National Nanotechnology Initiative, which is basically spanned, started under President Clinton, Bush actually enacted it into law, and Obama kind of carried it. Now it's this big initiative, and it's running every year, and looks like the Trump administration will most likely fund it. But yes, as far as Obama era health initiatives, it's too soon to call how those will actually fare. Just a note on NIH, total budget is about $32 billion, or it was in fiscal year 2016. 80% of that money goes directly towards competitive grants over a lot of schools, universities, and research institutions. And one thing that's notable is it's NIH is split up between, in terms of their intramural research, between 27 different centers and institutes, and they themselves compete for funding, which isn't necessarily healthy in terms of getting everyone the money that they need to carry out their mission. So all of them have broad missions. Of course, the National Cancer Institute was the first one, and is generally well funded. But many of the others compete with funds in between themselves. Y'all can probably tell me more about that than I know. Most of my funding comes from, and has come from, NSF during grad school and even now. Intramural research programs take about 10% of NIH's total budget. And there are some folks that have kind of tracked the annual funding of individual researchers. So they did it as a function of the number of researchers at these intramural research program institutes, as a function of how much money they're getting. So basically, NIH is favoring big, long-term projects rather than new investigators, which is a problem I guess I'll talk about in just a sec. So for an R01 grant, it's around $250,000. So in the first category, there's almost 150 researchers that have even doubled. So getting into the second category takes several of those R01 grants. So many people are kind of flush with cash at these centers, whereas investigators at other institutions really compete for this money. I've also read that I think the total percent of the NIH budget during, I think from 2003 to 2014 grew from 9% to something like 12%, basically saying that as the NIH budget shrank, the amount of money that these intramural research centers actually grew, which made it more competitive for people that were getting extramural grants, especially new investigators. Cool, so I'm sure many of you have seen this graph before. I'll just run through it quickly. But this is it's kind of 1980 to 1990 through the 1990s is kind of the tail end of science policy people call the endless frontier. The endless frontier was the name of a report that was published, I guess, during the Truman administration that kind of set science policy up for the next 40 or 50 years, which basically is the standard model. Government does basic research, some applied research, helps that get into private industry, and then it becomes products for everyone to use, including health and biomedical research. And so generally what people thought was happening is that you were gonna see kind of like a linear growth in R&D funding from now until eternity. Basically, this funding wasn't gonna run out. Okay, well, sometime in 1998, they started this quick rise. Oh, here's the 1990 when the Human Genome Project was started. And that's when people point to where kind of NIH got this kind of special treatment from Congress in terms of getting bipartisan support. This big project that led later, 10 years down the road, 8 years down the road, to the doubling under the Bush administration. So here's that kind of exponential growth up to where kind of NIH was at its peak funding and peak success rate percentages. And since then, it's kind of even fallen off or stagnated over the years. And so I guess alongside the funding, the success rate has gone from about 30 to about just under 20%. So that's the amount of people that apply for NIH grants that actually receive them. So this, go ahead.
So you were about to say that it's the young investigators?
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, is a common strategy, is it right? Because universities know this,
uh-huh.
And departments know this, and that your best chance for success of getting a grant is having a track record with the agency.
Yeah.
And so one of the strategies for addressing that is to get, you know, to piggyback as a co-investigator of somebody who does already have a track record, so that
yeah.
you can start a track record
yeah.
yourself.
Right.
So I'm curious to find out how that effect gets
mm-hmm.
actually accounted for in these kinds of statistics.
Yeah, I mean that'd be a good thing to track. I think the study that I looked at, in particular, tracked just single investigators. I guess so, lead PI rather than co-PI. So that's where I got most of my numbers were from two studies. There was a study that looked very generally, not just at NIH, but I guess all the major federal science agencies, so NASA, NSF, DOD. And they basically saw that kind of a similar trend, not quite as dramatic as NIH, but it'd be interesting to go see how many co-PIs are, you know, having people my age sign on to grants,
and then later
getting, once you have this proof of record. So that I think that the first, let's see, I think it might be the next slide. No, I think it's, I have it later, but. Yeah, that'd be a good thing to track. I don't know if studies have done this, and I'll have to look, because there's a, so this study in PNAS came out just this week that was looking at the median age of first-time investigators, and it's something like
40-something.
Yeah, 40-something, and I think for some agencies it's even 51. Yeah, it's, it's not good. At NSF, they have, they have this career award that's specifically for young investigators, so people that are tenure track faculty at major research universities. And, yeah, it's tough. But yeah, I don't know if anyone's done that, so that'd be good to look at.
Sorry,
I have
another question. So is part of the significant drop-off maybe due to an increase in people who are, the increase in lab starting, increase in people who are submitting for these grants? Has the number of grants awarded gone up proportionally, perhaps, to the number of applications, or?
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. Like, when the boom happened, so many people rushed into biomedical sciences, and so there was this kind of supply and demand problem where all of a sudden you have, you know, people expecting to get grants going into this field and being second, third year graduate students, and you're like, well, what are my options going forward? You know, as long as that curve was continuing up, people just continued to flood the market, so to speak. All right, so that's NIH. Oh, and what I was going to say is that, so back to this graph, which is the total federal R&D as a percentage of the discretionary budget. During that same doubling of NIH, got a lot of people in other sciences upset, because the total percentage in the discretionary budget didn't change, which meant that NIH was getting more money than, say, NSF, NASA. Basically, things were coming out of their budgets. All the total discretionary budget didn't shift as a percentage, the total amount of the R&D spending as a percentage of the discretionary budget didn't change. So it basically meant like a reshifting of funds from other sciences to biomedical sciences. And I should note here, this is where some countries do a better job than we do in terms of organizing their scientific enterprise. There's no set procedure for setting budgets. There's no long-term plan. Most presidents don't even have a long-term plan. There's just no set science policy that says these are priorities. This is how priorities are set. It's basically up to the president and then up to the Congress to see how things go. But this is pretty much the only constant, more or less, in the whole process, is that this number hasn't changed. Since the early 70s. So Trump's skinny budget. Okay, so skinny refers to the fact that it is devoid of almost any detail on almost across the board. Exactly, it names some programs that it plans on either axing or significantly cutting. The big one, of course, is NIH. Where they want to do a $5.9 billion reduction down to about 29.9 billion. So that's a close to 20% reduction. But they also entirely axed what's known as ARPA-E, which is the Advanced Research Programs for Energy. It's a spinoff of DARPA for Energy that was created, I think, in 2010. When the second American Competes Act passed, and it basically gives it's like far-reaching, high-risk, high-reward proposals that look specifically at renewable energy and efficient uses of energy. But yeah, pretty much across the board, there are these giant cuts. Of course, RBE is at minus 100. You just said destroy the whole program. NIH takes a big hit. Many of the NOAA Office of Atmospheric Research also takes half, and so does the EPI, Office of R&D, and the EPA itself. So basically across the board, he's looking at these striking, hard to come up with a neutral term for this, but very strong cuts across the board. He also proposed cuts to the fiscal year 2017 budget, which, as I said earlier, is still not passed into law. It's on its what will be its third continuing resolution if they can't come up with something before the end of April. This is pretty unorthodox. Coming in basically and saying, you know, these are my priorities. This is what I'm going to do. Here's my new presidential budget. It's usually late, and there usually is a skinny budget, and it usually says, you know, some brief outline of what's going to happen, but nothing this dramatic has happened since the Reagan era. also what's coming out and saying, do this now, basically, while we're in a continuing resolution for the current fiscal year is pretty unorthodox. That hasn't happened that I'm aware of ever, and that includes a $1.2 billion cut to NIH. This came from a leaked document from OMB. I'm not sure exactly what leaked means, but Washington Post got their hands on it and published it. And it also targets the DOE Office of Efficient Energy and Renewable Energy. And as well, it's a $350 million cut to NSF. Most of the the appropriations subcommittees that have jurisdiction over these agencies and programs have come out in strong opposition, both Republican and Democrat. So it's unlikely that any of these changes will happen, or how they would happen, because so much of this money through the continuing resolution has already been actually given to the agency, so they'd have to take $1.2 billion and subtract it from the remaining unappropriated money for the last basically several months of the fiscal year until October. So that would be a challenging thing to do just from a logistical standpoint. So my kind of guess there is that none of these cuts would go into effect. But I guess we'll know by the end of April. They vote on the next continuing resolution over the fiscal year 2017 budget and sign it into law. Of course, then Trump can say, you know, I veto this and this doesn't work for me, come up with another continuing resolution, and then they'll go back and forth. But at some point, they have to pass the fiscal year 2017 before the actual year ends. Usually, they have to pass it before the year starts. So that's where they are right now. Cool. Oh, I do want to say, too, that most of these budget cuts, both fiscal year 17 and 18, come from the Heritage Foundation blueprint. It's called Blueprint for Balance, I think, something like that. And that provides a little bit more detail. It doesn't give any rationale for cutting programs, but it is pretty deep cuts across the board for most R&D Heritage Foundation blueprint. Many Heritage people wound up as in transition teams are now being hired by the Trump administration, so it's just kind of this attitude going in that we're going to get rid of the federal government. So that's where they are. So whether or not any of these things pass, it's very clear that the administration has devalued science and doesn't see it as a part of their agenda. But it's really not surprising considering their political agenda and current advisory makeup. There's no scientists in the White House, and there are very few department heads that relate to science that have been nominated and confirmed by the Senate. So the science advisor is usually this one senior aide to the president that is also the director, typically also the director of the Office of Science and Technology Policy, and is called upon by the president to kind of negotiate budgets and advise the president on various scientific issues. With Obama, the science advisor was appointed very, very early on. John Holdren was the director of this office, and the president's science advisor, and he was named before Obama even assumed office. That in itself was pretty rare. Most presidents, usually this person is below the cabinet in priority in terms of appointments, so I don't find it too surprising that Trump hasn't nominated a science advisor, though. Most presidents have done it before the fall. The one exception was President G.W. Bush, who waited until November of the following year after 9/11 to appoint one. And so most people point to that as kind of this indicator of science in the White House. So there hasn't been one yet. There's been some names, and I guess I can talk at length about that or take questions. But it's not surprising. Basically, all of his advisors are kind of focused on his political agenda. Not necessarily some agenda for R&D, it's just lower on the priority list. But what it is doing is setting a tone for the administration is just devaluing of science, which would be problematic. And I will say on an extremely negative note, once something is cut, it's very hard to uncut it. One good example is what's called the OTA, which is the Office of Technology Assessment, which was an advisory board for Congress, where they could go and get reports. I mean, it's kind of like the National Academy of Sciences, but something internal to Congress. And it has still been authorized in the sense that the office still exists, it just hasn't been appropriated any funds since the mid-90s. So effectively, it doesn't exist, although although it could, but it's just not on anyone's agenda. Cool, so here's where we are in terms of 3 years. We're in April, so there are two continuing resolutions, one in December before Congress broke for a recess, and then we're still kind of waiting on when the next continuing resolution will happen. A lot of times, if Congress can't agree on one big budget bill, they'll turn them into smaller budget bills, so several subcommittees will say, okay, we agree on this, House and Senate, let's pass just these three subcommittees as an omnibus bill, is what it's called. So the fact that we're here and you're asking for fiscal year 17 budgets, usually even in fiscal year 18, that he's still too late on some sense. He should be releasing his OSTP-OMB joint memo in a few months. Whether or not that happens, we'll see. The Office of Science and Technology Policy doesn't it exists in the sense that it has at least one person that sits in the office, but he hasn't built up that office yet at all, so it's unclear what role OSTP will have in budget making moving forward. So that's where we are. Okay, so these are quotes from Tom Cole and Roy Blunt that are basically up against this budget for fiscal year 2018, and they control the Appropriations Subcommittee for NIH. Cool, so to put Trump's skinny budget in context of the last decade or so, so under the Budget Control Act of 2011, basically set up, you probably heard about this sequestration that was set to take place in 2013. So there's some lines here. So this was this is where funding was projected before the Budget Control Act, and now with the Budget Control Act, sets caps for discretionary and non-discretionary spending, and it's kind of jumped around a little bit, but it's generally decreasing, and it's supposed to decrease by a certain amount every year for the next, I think, it's like 20 years, so to 2021. Then there is the Trump budget in red, which basically, this is for non-defense spending, which basically cuts, they want to cut $54 billion from non-defense discretionary spending, and they want that to come out of, they want that then to go to defense discretionary spending. So what's notable about that is that currently isn't allowed under the Budget Control Act, so the Budget Control Act sets limits kind of as a proportion to kind of keep defense from being ballooned. So saying, you know, pass $54 billion to defense and take it out of non-defense isn't allowed at the moment. So they'd actually have to pass new legislation that says, like, change these caps. They basically need a new Budget Control Act, and that is very unlikely because they need a full majority to pass that. So they need 60 votes, and that, from what I understand, that would be pretty hard to do. So that's good news in some sense that he can't just, like, take money from one from discretionary and put it in, or take money from non-defense discretionary and put it in the defense discretionary without passing a new law. So that's there. So for NIH, there's this, like I said before, this 25 billion or 19% decrease. It also eliminates one entire institute, the Fogarty International Center, which focuses on global health. And it's also trying to do, it has some language, I guess I'll discuss in a second, for administrative reform. So that's the 2018 budget. And then here's the fence, so there's Trump again. Here's the pre-sequestration line, and then here's the Budget Control Act. So he basically, this line is impossible. That's what I'm trying to say, unless they pass new law. So that's very unlikely. Okay, so 2017, pretty much all key legislators said, like, we're not doing this. So I don't think that will happen, but we will know at the end of the month. Okay, so comparison to Reagan. So it's interesting here, there's a good blog post on AAAS that basically goes through and talks philosophically these two administrations. And basically what it looks like they're trying to do is return federal agencies to their original missions, which is basically anything that the government shouldn't be doing, anything that individual civilians can't do themselves. So anything like tech transfer, they don't like. Consequently, the sense of funding lots of basic research, so because most people can't build and maintain an accelerator, for instance. So big projects or NASA, things like that, NASA might not be the best example anymore, but NSF that's doing basic research and NIA's basic research, they just don't want to do anything applied. They want industry to kind of take the realms once kind of government does its piece. So the Trump administration seems to be that in that same vein where it's, it wants to get rid of R&D, which is this thing that's supposed to basically help commercialize really groundbreaking energy technologies and transform them into solutions for energy problems. They're also getting rid of what are known as the Small Business Innovation Research, the Small Business Technology Transfer Programs at DOE, which basically help move technologies along. And so they're getting rid of anything that basically would compete with industry, theoretically. So that's kind of their agenda. This under the Reagan administration, this ended up funding a lot of big science. Under Reagan was when the superconducting super collider, which never actually got built, was first started, and this goes back to your question, is this was this 20-year project, and they actually dug the tunnels, started laying pipe, and then the project died about 10 years later before it was anywhere near completion. So that can be a problem. Cool, so they also mentioned in their budget, the budget also reduces administrative costs, rebalance, federal contributions to research funding. So Secretary Price came out and said that they can basically just get rid of the $6 billion by removing overhead costs. So this is pretty ludicrous, actually. Like, this doesn't make any sense. And I'm sure y'all all know that coming from people that actually get INH grants, this is just, it doesn't make any sense. So some percentage of each grant goes to administrative costs or facilities or other things that aren't necessarily just research. And so the administration is saying, well, just wipe that out. You should just focus on research, don't do anything that isn't strictly research and development. Last year NIH paid $6.4 billion just in overhead, so that's 27% of all extramural research. So there's this plot, it's online, but it basically some integrative graph, it doesn't look very good here, I'm sorry, but basically what's important to take away is that this is the NIH calculated overhead rate, and it sits at about 30%, and usually what PIs or universities or institutes do is that they negotiate some of that back and it ends up being closer to 53%, and so that's on average. But for many institutions, they'll set limits on how much overhead you can take. So this has affected me directly. If I get a grant, I got a grant from NIH, and then if it's a specific type of grant that I'm already giving away some percentage of money to administrative stuff in the university, so that's really important. So basically just wiping it out, it's not some sort of slush fund that can be negotiated, it's something really important that needs to be paid for somehow. And so basically getting rid of that would then place a huge burden on PIs and institutions and universities themselves to actually make up this administrative overhead themselves, and they have no structure for doing this as of now. So that is bad and basically makes no sense. So I don't see that happening. They'll probably take cuts from other places if the cuts do go through. Okay, so I guess I was gonna talk about four things in terms of outlook. Does anyone have any questions about this budget process, Trump budget?
So what are the major sources of these overheads? Like, I've read a little bit about this on PBS. They mentioned rent, banal things like electricity. What are some other examples?
Yeah, so rent, utilities. So for instance, Baker Institute is a good example. So if I get some X amount of money, $100,000 or something from NSF, then the university, so Baker Institute might not be the best example. Let's take the physics department. So physics department on campus, just in terms of administrative costs for executing the grant. So things like, I can open this question up. If anyone's gotten a grant from NIH and then had to pay administrative costs, I think they're probably different from the grants I've received at the Baker Institute. But essentially, that's correct. Like, they can be anything from facilities, like utilities, like paying plumbing, electricity, and rent on campus. So the Baker Institute pays the university some amount of money just to have a building. There, they also pay just to maintain the building in terms of utilities costs and electricity, all those things matter. And so then
costs also include, like, for example, most universities have an Office of Contracts and Grants whose
yeah.
job it is to help you actually submit the grants that you were that fund you. Those people need to get paid.
Yeah.
Computers that submit all those things need to get paid.
Yeah.
So a lot of that is what they call overhead or indirect costs.
You can also charge interest for borrowing for building a building.
Yeah.
To it's a big source for some.
Yeah, I could say the Baker Institute has a fair amount of support staff that help people like me, right, get grants. So that's
I have a question.
Uh-huh.
Do you have any insight into what's going to happen to, so DOD, I know that Heritage Foundation had not commented on DOD's CDMRP or their medical research
yeah.
program, but they, CDMRP provides a significant chunk of money.
Yeah.
And so some researchers are trying to think of strategies to kind of leverage that and go into DOD funding.
Yeah.
But word on the street is that he's going to cut from that too.
Yeah.
Do you have any insight into that?
I don't. And I assume that he will. But I don't, since they haven't released any numbers, I don't know. And the same thing with, there's a blog on Plus One a few days ago about, you know, tips for young medical researchers, and one of them was just apply to other agencies besides NIH. Well, kind of all in the same boat there, in terms of if someone was to apply to NIH, or excuse me, if someone was typically in the biomedical field, but they kind of tailored the research so it makes it more applicable to NSF's mission or DOD's mission, then you're competing with a different pool of people. So yeah, but I really want to hit home that I this budget, even Paul Ryan came out and said that NIH isn't going to go through at this level or anywhere close to it. Like, he's Paul Ryan. So it's kind of like, I don't think that many of these cuts are going to happen. What I do think it is it's a signal to the scientific community, legislators, to say we're not playing around. Like, we're very serious about, you know, these cuts. So having being a starting point, Price getting up before the House Committee on Health, Labor, and Education and then defending this budget is a significant thing. Saying like, okay, this is, you know, here I am to support the president, support the president's budget that some of it makes very little sense, is a significant thing, because it basically, it's somebody who's a health professional is going out there and saying, defending it as like it, as a rational plan. So that's, but I, as far as a specific DOD program, I don't have any, I will say that across the board, there will be, where there is, kind of agreement between the White House and Congress is on environmental funding and funding for basic research sciences and energy. So the House Science Committee, so Lamar Smith, who chairs the oversight committee that has oversight over NSF, NASA, NIST, and others, has come out and said, you know, we just want to cut. They outlined it in a letter to the Appropriations Committee. They said, here's our agenda. We plan on cutting this particular thing from NOAA if we can. And it aligns well with what the President said. We plan on cutting this from EPA. We plan on cutting this from other sectors of the Department of Interior. So those are the NIH, I think, stand the test of time. Well, this is my opinion now. I think that NIH will ultimately do fine in the 2018 budget. But I do not think that U.S. Global Change Research Program, NOAA, EPA, I think those that will take very hard cuts, and I don't think that it's, I think that there's at least agreement in terms of Congress, executive branch, legislative branch, that's what you need to actually move things forward. So I think there'll be a lot of pushback on NIH, and the physical sciences as well, pushback from Congress, for things like climate research is gonna be hit in a very serious way. Go ahead.
So, How do all these budget cuts translate into job creation for the administration? That's like really nice. It sounds like
answer to your own question. Yeah. I think in that way it doesn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah, so are we supposed to like go into the military now just because boosting up the military?
Yeah, they won't run me. I don't think, I don't know. I need to gain at least 20 pounds.
Yeah, I don't know. I really think that it is problematic in terms of job creation and the
research base of biomedical researchers and professionals. I think we're going to think for NIH, if funding continues along that level where it's either stagnating or decreasing, that'll really hit young people like yourselves and myself, the artist, even if we are on the coattails of co-PI with most of my Dr. Lane and Dr. Matthews, and that's helpful for me. I haven't been able to get my own grant yet. So yeah, I don't. In terms of job creation, I haven't. So this is the role of several other pieces of the government. So one, the Congressional Budget Office usually makes these types of analyses and says like, all right, well, if you cut this amount of money from NIH, here's how this can affect this particular market, and they give you numbers. The White House also has the Council of Economic Advisors, which does studies just like this, which basically says, okay, like you're cutting this amount of money from, you know, what's that gonna do for X market or for jobs in this sector? And we'll actually do robust economic studies. And that itself is problematic because up until Trump, the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors was on the cabinet, and he has not been named. He's basically been demoted to a non-cabinet person, so he's not sitting at the cabinet like the rest of the cabinet members. So that in itself is, in my opinion, not good. So the CEA, in that sense, is there to serve the president, basically give the administration impartial to the best of economic, scientific advice. This is what we know. And OCP on that, it kind of has roles in that way. OCP also, in addition to the National Science and Technology Council, which coordinates, they also have an external set of, like an expert advisory committee called the PCAS, which is the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology. And this also does kind of, they're not paid by the administration. They usually have other jobs. They're professors, ex-military, business professionals, and they say, you know, we've done this study, here's what we know. We don't have to represent the president in any way. But for somebody like on the National Economic Council, or somebody that's the Secretary Price, for instance, he has to defend the president. It's his job to represent the president. But for the Council of Economic Advisors, it's also the same. They're independent. They give advice to the president based on the analysis that they've run. It has nothing to do with the president's agenda, so it's really important that that information gets passed in. And the same thing goes for climate change or anything else, basically, or economic analysis, having this impartial, apolitical perspective in crafting policy. So that's a whole other discussion. But yeah, I think you're right. I think in terms of biomedical workforce, deflating the NIH budget is the last thing you want to do. And certainly, had they known even in 1998, the effects of raising it that quickly without long-term commitment, I think they would have done something differently. But that, of course, was a political move, too. I mean, George W. Bush, I mean, that was something he really championed. And so he got Congress behind him, and they did what they did. So I don't think ultimately it was a good thing. But yeah, so rapid fluctuations are really what's the worst. So like a 2% decrease is, on some level, it will contribute, but it won't be something like, you know, 10% increase, then an 8% decrease. That in itself is really bad for those reasons that you mentioned earlier.
So I have two closely related questions. First, what is driving the increase in intramural research programs as a proportion of NIH budget? Is it Congress, or is it decisions by the NIH leadership? And the second question, which is related to that, for example, in NASA, with a Trump skinny budget planning on killing Europa Lander, there's some talk of, oh, certain systems from this mission may be able to be folded into other missions, and then we'll save the technology. And so the question is, what is the role, you know, the Congress decides something, it filters down 10, 12 levels before it gets down to a frontline person.
Yeah.
So what is the role that agency, non-political appointees and political appointees have in, how does Congress's intent get filtered down? What role do they play in modifying how that may affect people?
How Congress's intent or how the people that
what
actually
is, what is the role that the actual agency personnel have
yeah.
in mediating between what Congress originally wanted and what actually happens?
Yeah, so I think that the agency has quite a bit of agency in this way. Like, so basically, to answer your first question first, I think that it's that the that shift between extramural and intramural happened not because of any specific decision that some agency administrator made, but more just because of the way general trends in NIH funding, which are funding larger, big projects to known people that already have proven themselves. So at these, you have these government researchers that have been career servants for the last 30 years, they will probably get favor over a recent PhD or newly hired professor. And then as far as how Congress's decision to say, okay, so this program has this amount of money, then yeah, it's up, basically up to then program administrators to decide how that money is then appropriated their own agency. So you get this big kind of top-down decision that says, okay, you have $500 million to complete X. That's up next to the agency to do that. Cool. Yeah, and there are questions of saying, so if Scott Pruitt, right, is head of the APA, then, I mean, what is he actually, you know, how much impact will he have when you have, you know, 10,000 EPA employees that are long-term civil servants that want to protect the environment? You know, I mean, on some level, they're going to continue to do their job regardless of what he's saying, as long as they still have their job. So, okay, I talked about workforce. I spoke longer than I thought I would. Okay, yeah. I think one thing that usually in discussion in the science policy world is this kind of shift from post-war era where the government funded 2/3 of all basic research and industry only funded 1/3. And now that role has reversed. But one thing people don't talk about, this is a recent graph from I think last week in Science, Jeffrey Mervis basically plotted out philanthropic efforts. So I think if NIH is cut to some extent, then I think we'll see more activity from some people like Gates Foundation, Wellcome Trust, Simons Foundation, although they're currently very small in terms of the total annual budget of NIH. They still have fairly large endowments and are players in this field, so that follows into there. And, I was gonna say, I think EPA now is getting a bit of traction in terms of there's a protest today outside of a New York congressperson. There's March for Science later this month. This issue's becoming very public in a way that is kind of pulling scientists together to kind of make a statement. And many of you might be in Culberson's district. If you are in his district, then you can contact him directly. And a fax is one way to pester them. You can also call. And I do think that these things matter. If there's a particular issue, they're preparing next year's budget, say like, no, I don't agree with, you can make it very short, you can write a letter, you can call and you can chew somebody out on the phone if that makes you feel better. It basically allows you to say like, no, I don't agree with NOAA's budget, and these numbers are available, you can actually reach them, call and fax.
How long do we have to be able to contact them about the budget?
So for fiscal year 17, so the decision has been made, most of it's been appropriate already, so I would say for fiscal year 2018, this is going to be a long, excruciating process. There's two continuing resolutions already for 17, and I think for 2018 it'll probably be the same, and then it'll probably go back and forth between the President and the two houses of Congress. On this level, many people on both House and Senate, Republican and Democrat, are all very much against certain sections of the President's skinny budget. And so I think it could go back and forth for a very long time. So you have plenty of time to contact people. And so Culberson is the chair of the Appropriations Subcommittee for NIST, NASA, NSF, and OCP. And Cruz is chair of the Senate Commerce Committee that has oversight for NASA and those agencies as well. So he's your senator, and it's my senator. And Culberson is not in my district, but I have many friends that live in that district. They write letters. We also host town halls and other things, and these are your representatives on some. I'm now putting on my policy advocate hat, but I think it really does make a difference to call and make your voice heard. And this service online is pretty tight, actually. Like, you can write a letter or draft something and upload it and fax it, and it actually goes to the machine. And they use faxes kind of this way where they're like, we're not, you know, on a day where they're, you know, for instance, on during the immigration ban, they would just hang up their phone and take the phone off the hook, but the fax they leave on, so you can just fax all day if you want. Which we did. So I think that's something that that you can do. You can also ask to meet if you have research or if you have an invested interest in these things. You can actually go and try and meet with them. And so for certain things like Europa, Culberson is a big Europa stan. Like, he loves Europa, and he's been like after Europa for a long time. And he's kind of like looking like, I want to go to Europa now. Like, this is the ice planet. Let's go there. And so I think if someone has an opinion on that, you can voice that to him. So I think those things are good. I don't think that you have to be passive. I have mixed views on the March for Science, I'm happy to talk about that if you want. But yeah, generally, I think that it's not. To kind of close, I don't think that I don't think the fiscal year 2017 budget has any legs at all. I don't think that any of these cuts. And we'll also just find out in 3 weeks, which is also good. For fiscal year 2018, like I said, I think that climate programs are going to take a real hit. I think there's agreement between legislative and executive branch. But I think NIH has been, for a long time, even if it hasn't seen continuing increased funding, I think that it has been, it generally gets bipartisan support. I don't know about things like Brain Initiative, Precision, so any Obama-era big statement initiatives. The future of those are unclear, but in terms of NIH, I will echo Francis Collins. Last week he said, I don't see a problem. Of course, he also represents the president now on some level, but I think he was also speaking for himself. The 21st Century Cures Act is a good indicator that there is still strong bipartisan support from the White House, at least for certain sectors of NIH grants. So with that, I guess I'll close and take questions, more questions.